Measuring MCP flexion, you want your patient in a seated position with their elbow on the table. Grab the stationary arm of your goniometer, put it on the desired metacarpal. So for in this case, we are doing the third digit. So on the third metacarpal, axis is on the MCP joint right here. And the movement arm will be on the proximal phalanx. So it'll look something like this. So Rachel, what I want you to do is ball up that hand for me as far as you can go. There we go. Right here, we're looking at 90 degrees. Once again, you'll be doing that to measure all the MCP joints. Do that in the same process for all of them. Measuring MCP hyperextension. Once again, patient position will be seated with their elbow resting on a table or solid surface with their hand extended upward. Just like flexion, you're going to measure your goniometer, stationary arm on the desired metacarpal, the axis on the MCP joint, and the movement arm on the proximal phalanx. Now, when most people, when they first start doing this, they want to put the axis right here on this crease because they think that's the MCP joint. But if you turn the hand, you'll see that the MCP joint is actually right here, right? So let's go on the opposite side of the hand. So right over here, right here is where the true MCP joint is, not up here, right here. So you want to grab the axis of your goniometer. So I'm going to do the third metacarpal. So right here, I'm going to place the axis of the goniometer on the MCP. The stationary arm I'm going to put on the metacarpal, and the movement arm I'm going to put on the measured with the proximal phalanx. Okay, Rachel, I want you to extend your hand backwards as far as you can go. Have that right on there. Right on there. There we go. We're looking at 30 degrees of hyperextension. Measuring PIP and DIP flexion. Patient will be in a seated or comfortable position. The measuring process for both of these joints is similar, and so we'll do them both in this video. So to begin off with, to measure these joints, you want your stationary arm on the proximal phalanx and your movement arm on the middle phalanx with your axis on the PIP joint, like this. So Rachel, what I want you to do is I want you to curl your fingers into a bear claw and keep it in that. Yep, keep it just like that. Once again, proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and right over the PIP joint. So right here, we're looking at 120 degrees. And you will do this same process with each of the PIP joints, as you can see here. To measure the DIP joint, you will do relatively the same thing, except this time you'll have the stationary arm on the middle phalanx and the movement arm on the distal phalanx with the axis right over the DIP joint. Right here, we're looking at 70 degrees. Measuring PIP and DIP extension. The patient will be in a seated or comfortable position. But also with this, the hand, it can be resting on its side on the table, it can be up in this position, it can be any position you want to, but whatever position you have the patient in, make sure that the fingers are not resting against an object to promote more extension than they actually have. So you want to be careful about that. So when measuring extension, it will be identical to measuring PIP and DIP flexion. The same process will happen. So you will have your stationary arm of your goniometer on the proximal phalanx, your movement arm on the middle phalanx, and the axis on the PIP joint. So Rachel, what I want you to do for me is I want you to pretend like you cannot extend your fingers very far. Yeah, just about right there, yeah. So I'm gonna put it on the proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and the axis over the joint. Now, normally, she should be able to extend her finger to full extension, which is up here, right?
So what we want to do is we want to see how big this gap is. So I'm going to bring down my movement arm and see how many degrees she's lacking. So right here, we're looking at 65 degrees of that she's lacking in extension. So because she's lacking 65 degrees, we would call that negative 65 degrees of extension. And you will do that for all of her PIP joints to test for extension. Same thing for the DIP, except instead of putting it on the proximal, we put it on the middle and the distal. So middle, distal, axis on the DIP. We want to see how much she's lacking. So it's once again, it's supposed to be up here, but it's down here instead. So we're looking at 30 degrees she's lacking of extension here. Let me put that better. There we go. So maybe a little less than 30 degrees. So that would be considered, let's call it negative 25 degrees of extension.
Measuring MCP abduction. Patient's hand will be on a flat surface. To measure MCP abduction, what you want to have is your goniometer axis will be directly over the desired MCP joint. So in this case, we're going to measure the third MCP abduction. So right there on the third MCP, the stationary arm over the desired metacarpal, which is in this case the third metacarpal, and the movement arm over the proximal phalanx. Now you want to make sure that you measured up with the proximal phalanx instead of the fingernail or the distal phalanx, as the distal phalanx and the proximal phalanx will most likely give you very different measurements. So in this, always measure it with the proximal phalanx. Now Rachel, what I want you to do is I want you to spread your hand fingers outward like this. Now, once you did that, you noticed that the middle finger did not move, but these fingers did. So the third digit, we are going to measure both radially and ulnarly. So I'm going to put my axis on the third MCP, stationary arm on the third metacarpal, and on the proximal phalanx for the movement arm. So Rachel, what I want you to do is I want you to move just your middle finger to the ulnar side. So we're looking here at, that's looking about 15, 16 degrees of abduction. Now I want you to bring it to the radial side. Measuring it here to, let's go with 12 to 13 degrees of radial abduction. Now that is only done with the middle finger. These other fingers, such as the second, the fourth, and the fifth, you will measure only one direction. So you will do it in about this manner, about right here, and about right here. And you'll measure how far they move into abduction.
Measuring digit composite flexion. Patient will be in the seated position, elbow on table or solid surface with hand extended in the air. The object of finding this measurement is to find the distance between the tips of the fingers all the way down to the distal palmar crease. Rachel, if you could, ball up your hand for me as much as you can. So this would be considered good flexion because the tips of her fingers are literally wedged against her distal palmar crease. Okay, extend them back out. So to make this measurement, you have to first understand where the distal palmar crease is. A lot of people, they expect to find an actual crease in the hand, but the distal palmar crease isn't that. The distal palmar crease is instead, what you want to do is you want to find the crease on this side and a crease over here, and then make an imaginary line in your head of where those two creases connect to each other. So right here, this is about her distal palmar crease. So Rachel, once again, I want you to ball your hand up for me, except this time I want you to pretend that you cannot go all the way with flexion, okay? Very good. So to make this measurement, I'm going to get the distal end of my goniometer and I'm gonna wedge it in her palmar crease right here. And then I'm going to make the measurement tool, place the measurement tool against her fingernail, or I can do it against the bed of the finger.
But whatever you do, make sure that it's consistent, because if you don't, you'll get different measurements. So right here and right here. Yeah, bring back your hand there. So I'm going to measure it up with the fingernail, and I'm looking at about 25 millimeters. And then I can do the same thing with all of her fingers in that respect.